Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God. To the saints who are at Ephesus and who are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Try to guess what the theme is. Well, as we begin chapter 4 of Ephesians tonight, Paul moves from discussing the power in God's love in chapter 3. Those of you that have been studying with us know really that the first three chapters were all about God's love for us, endeavoring to make us feel secure and loved and cared for forever in that love. Now Paul moves in chapter 4 to discussing what God's love now produces in our life. As we grow in understanding how much God's love is for us and how secure we are in it, this is what is manifested naturally in our life, beginning with chapter 4. Actually, chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, to me, are three of the most practical verses in all of Scripture. The first three verses of chapter 4. Because they tell us how to be content in every circumstance of life. How to just feel at peace every day, no matter what I'm facing, no matter what I feel is missing in my life. How do I just feel at peace and content? These three verses tell us. They tell us how to maintain unity with all believers. Also, we see in these first three verses what removes arguments and tension in a marriage, which prevents divorce. There would be no divorce in any marriage where God were growing the truths of these three verses. We also see what removes arguments and judgmentalness in all other relationships. Bottom line, in these first three verses, we see the inner heart qualities that God's love produces in our life, all of which produce peace and peaceful relationships. The people that rub shoulders with us feel that peace, because we're at peace. The source is in these first three verses. We're at peace. People will say to their friends, I just feel peace when I talk to them. Because, again, what all three of these verses Paul tells us as he concludes this brief little subject in verse 3, what they all produce is peace. Peace in our life, peace in our relationships, peace in our home, peace in our marriage. With that, let's read chapter 4, just verses 1 through 3. Paul begins, "Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." Now tonight, I want to answer just two questions. First, what did Paul mean by introducing himself as a prisoner of the Lord? Because that's the key or the source of everything else he tells us here. He's an example of it. What does he mean by that? Secondly, then, how do we walk humbly with each other, specifically our spouse, our friends, others? That's the first heart quality Paul mentions here in verse 2. Then we'll consider the other three qualities that we just read: gentleness, patience, and showing tolerance for one another next week and the following week. So next week is how to walk in all my dealings gently. I wish we could just hold over instead of making this 45 minutes, make it an hour and a half. I don't mind if I sound like a broken record when I come to various passages in Scripture, and I'm seeing this in light of basically studying and teaching about half the Bible, half the books. God has etched these three verses and continues to etch them deeper and deeper in my life. I just praise Him for His grace power to do that. Because I look at how the truths we're going to consider tonight, next week, and the following week. Tonight, what does it mean to walk humbly with you, with my wife, with every other believer? Next week, what does it mean to walk gently? Doesn't mean we don't discuss issues. How do we discuss issues gently? With our friend we're very concerned about, with our child, in a way that results in peace, not strife and anger and division. These are huge. We all know this, we live in relationships. In our home, at work, at our church, with our friends. It's all relational. And it's so interesting to me that Paul moves directly from his three chapters in discussing the love of God for us to bang, beginning in chapter 4, here's how that love is manifested in our relationships that encourages others versus others feeling demeaned and judged, that makes others feel secure instead of insecure, that causes others to feel at peace around us instead of hesitant because they're not sure what's going to come out of our mouth next. That's what these three verses contain. That's why I had to take 3 weeks to discuss them. So tonight, first, what does prisoner of the Lord mean? Because again, I said the answer to all these other questions is how do I walk patiently in all relationships with my rebellious child, with a difficult coworker? How do I walk patiently has its source in how Paul introduced himself. Verse 1 again begins with the words, "Therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord." Also, back in chapter 3, the previous chapter, verse 1, Paul introduces himself the same way. "For this reason I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus." What does he mean by that? Well, we first need to remember here that Paul was writing this letter to the Ephesian Christians from his prison quarters or his prison cell in Rome. He's in prison. He's confined. We would think of it as he has no personal freedom. And why was he being confined there? He was imprisoned for simply telling the people throughout the town and the community and the area that Jesus was the Messiah and they wanted to forgive all their sins and freely give them eternal life. He was imprisoned because he was telling the people how to be eternally saved and experience God's freedom in their life. And they throw him in jail. So, it's easy to see that he was imprisoned for a very unjust cause. What could be more unjust than that? Yet he tells us how he felt during this time of great injustice. I love seeing these verses together. I, Paul, the prisoner, he's in prison. But I notice he doesn't say, I, Paul, the prisoner of the Roman guards. That's pretty interesting, isn't it? He's in prison. He doesn't even say, I, Paul, the prisoner of Rome. This is interesting. I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus. And how did he feel there, being in prison for a very unjust cause? Well, Philippians 4:11 tells us, he said, not that I speak from want. Paraphrased, Paul would say, I don't even have my personal need to get out. Because let's go back, he says, I'm a prisoner of God. I'm not a prisoner of these bars. If God wants me to be somewhere else, there's no iron gates on earth that can contain me. True? That's what he said. And because he believed that, he said, not that I speak from want, for I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. How would all of us like to feel that way all the time? Just always content, 24/7. Get up in the morning content. Hear this difficult news on the telephone from still content. Not that I don't pray, but still content. Dealing with a rebellious child or two. Not that I don't pray, but still content. Paul said, whether I'm experiencing a terrible injustice as I am now, I'm content. If I lose my job, I'm content. That's what he said. If my boss doesn't pay me fairly, I'm content. I bring this up because someone in the class was concerned about this a couple weeks ago. They shared this with me when we were having lunch. If people spread false rumors about me, Paul says I'm content. Didn't he? I've learned to be content in every circumstance of life. Paul would say, even if my spouse continues to be unkind to me, even though I'm being kind to her or him, I'm still content. Now you talk about reading a verse that causes us to just feel our knees buckle and say, Lord, make me this way. We all know we can't make ourselves this way. We can't give ourselves an ounce of contentment. Our flesh is too strong. But how about this? What we've just discussed in 10 minutes, buckling our, I mean, I feel it right now. Lord, make me even more this way. Only you can do it. With the truths of your word and the truth we're considering tonight. Well, how could Paul say this? The answer lies in how he viewed himself going through life, meeting up with various difficulties every day. He again said, I'm just a prisoner of the Lord. By that he meant God. Paul meant, God's very personal to me. I've become acquainted with him and his power and his love for me. And he's greater than anything on earth by far. And he is sovereign over my life and over all that concerns me, not any earthly circumstance or person. If God wants my paycheck to be more, it'll be more. If God wants this circumstance to change, it'll change like that. But what if it doesn't change, Rodney, and I don't get any more work next month? Well, God didn't promise to take care of us by giving us enough work. He just promised to take care of us. And he does it in miraculous ways. And sometimes he allows some of us to go out of work for a period of time to prove and to break us further from trusting in ourself and relying on ourself to take care of ourselves, to prove that he is our sovereign God who loves us to the extent that we saw last week, and he has taken care of us when we get a check in the mail for $500 from somebody that we didn't even know was coming, and it just met the needs of the bills that I had to pay in the next 2 weeks. I've heard people tell me that so many times. More specifically, Paul meant when he said, I'm just a prisoner of the Lord, is any injustice that happens to me, God will bring good out of it for me, according to Romans 8:28, Genesis 50:20, and a number of other verses where we've seen the same truth. So this person cheated me, yeah. But God's going to make that right to me. And he's sovereign. He created everything. He's the how great thou art, God. As we saw last week, he's encased me with that thick egg white in that hard-boiled egg, and I see myself as just the yolk. And the shell of his sovereignty is protecting me 24/7. Paul would further go on and say, any lack of reciprocity from a friend doesn't at all bother me. Because again, God is taking care of me. 1 Peter 5:7 and many other verses. Paul would even say, and I say this after being a parent for so many years and sharing with many parents, even all my failures as a parent don't imprison me, Paul would say. He said, I'm content with every situation. And how can he say even all my failures as a parent don't imprison me? Because he said, I belong to a sovereign God who's not only sovereign over me, but everything else. Whoa. You mean my failures as a parent don't permanently doom my kid to hell? That's what I mean. You mean God's going to accomplish his will on behalf of my children regardless of all my failures? That's exactly what I mean. You want to see it in Scripture? I don't want you to take it from me. Isaiah 46:10 says, God speaking, my purpose will be established and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. Those words can't fail. They cannot fail. God knew all of us parents were frail. He told us we're just dust. We're full of failure. So God is sovereign over my life and my kids. Now I see deeper into what Paul meant when he had this little infamous introduction that sometimes we just race right over and go into the rest of the chapter. I, Paul, a prisoner of the Lord. The only one I'm encased with is God. So Paul's claim to be a prisoner of the Lord wasn't just some half-hearted, sound good spiritual statement. But it was the very source of his daily contentment and joy. especially in what you and I would think of as worrisome or unfair situations. Paul spoke to many of them, but listen how clear this one is. In 2 Corinthians 12:15, he said, I'm reading from the Living Bible paraphrase. Listen how clearly he puts this. I'm glad to give you myself and all I have for your spiritual good, even though it seems that the more I love you, the less you love me. How much clearer could that be? Paul says, I'm in a relationship here with a lot of you people. And it often seems to me, the more I give of myself to you, the more I love you, the more I extend of myself sacrificially to you, the less you care for me. That's what he said. But he concluded, that's okay. Because God has made me content. My peace, my happiness isn't subject to how you treat me in return to how I treat you, praise God, Paul said. I'm loved and protected and treated by someone far greater than any of you. Amass the greatest crowd on earth. I'm loved and cared for and promised to be taken care of by someone far greater than the biggest crowd you can amass on earth. So, kick up your heels. I give myself to you. You don't give anything back. In fact, often what you give back is negative. That's okay. Now, it's important to realize here, Paul didn't do anything to become God's prisoner. He didn't say, I'm going to work hard at this and try to achieve this level of relationship with God. He didn't do anything. How did he become God's prisoner? He just recognized that he was. Through what God revealed to him about his love for him. As we saw in last week's lesson. And just to summarize, he said God's love redeemed him, then protects him throughout this life. Again, with that thick egg white completely encasing him and him being the yolk. And nothing can penetrate the sovereignty of God's eggshell and then the thick egg white loving him and surrounding him. We saw last week where he taught us God's love strengthens him in every circumstance that he needs to be strengthened in. I've heard a number of Christians say to me, and I used to do the same thing, when they see somebody else going through a difficulty, I don't know how I'd handle that. You can't anticipate the power of God's grace. He gives it to us when we need it. If someone would have told me 3 years ago, I'd go into the hospital, I'm jogging my normal 4 miles a day, and I get this little chest pain, but 15 years ago I had an angioplasty, so I called Arlie and went to see him, and he said, I'm going to send you down to get a checkup. And then I go down to the hospital, and I think, I won't be there long, this will be a piece of cake. And within a half a day, I'm in the surgery room having quadruple bypass surgery on my heart. Now, if somebody would have told me 10 years ago, Daryl, this is going to happen to you, and I want you to anticipate it and have peace about it, I've experienced in several circumstances of my life, and so have many, if not most of you, that God's strength is sufficient for our need. We find ourselves facing something we never, ever imagined facing. And God's strength is sufficient. He promised that it would be. If it weren't, there wouldn't be a God. God's grace is sufficient. I couldn't have imagined dealing with certain circumstances in our family life, my health, the health of other family members when I was 20 or 30. I couldn't imagine. I'd have been freaked out if somebody would have told me, this is going to happen, and one of your kids is going to do this, and then tell you this, and this is going to happen, and this is going to... I tell you, God's grace is a powerful thing. And it does meet us in our time of need. And you don't have to worry about trying to feel that way now. And when somebody else gives a testimony about how God's strength was sufficient, you don't have to sit there. You shouldn't sit there and say, ooh, that scares me. No, when you're in it, God takes care of you. I forget where it was, but I was studying a passage in Scripture that discussed this at the time I made our third trip to Israel with Bill Perkins. And we went back to one of my favorite places where it's probably the most emotional place to me. I'm trying to think of the place where they've uncovered, if any of you think of the name of it, it's on the tip of my tongue, but where they've uncovered this great big arena, and you can see the stones that they've uncovered that are about as high as this wall and a few of the bench seats, where Christians used to be put in there and they'd let the lions and tigers out and they'd rip those Christians apart. And people would sit up in the bleachers. Chris, what was the name of that town? Bethshean? Bethshean. To me, of the whole trip, it was the most emotional time, but I love to go there because it reminds me of the power of God's sustaining grace. I stood right in the center of that arena. And you can still see the holes in the walls. You don't see the doors. They were wood or whatever, and they've rotted away. But you can see the caged areas where they kept the wild animals, and they released them. And the crowds would just cheer and roar as these Christians would be shredded. And I thought to myself initially, How does a Christian handle this? And I wish I remembered the passage that God had taken to me. It had me studying right then in Scripture. But God had shown me through His Word that His grace is sufficient to meet every circumstance we find ourselves in. It's miraculous. And I was standing there as Bill Perkins was saying, Daryl, underneath your feet, there are pools of Christians' blood shed here. And it was amazing how God brought back the thought, but God's grace was sufficient. Excuse me. God always sustains His people. He created us. He created us, our frail bodies. He can sure miraculously sustain them in any circumstance in life. Paul also told us last week how God's love accomplishes God's good for him every day, no matter how things appear or what injustices he experiences. He concluded that he'd never lack any good thing because of God's love, and we saw that the same is true for us. I just wanted to remind us of this great verse again. This is in that patchwork quilt of verses. This has to be one of them that's the source of our contentment. This, some of you know, when I wrote that little book on my top 10 verses, if I had to categorize all the verses that have been, I felt so powerful in my life, but if I had to reduce the 65 or 70 that I came up with a number of years ago to the top 10, which ones would I include? This is one of them. This is Paul's source of contentment. Psalm 34:10, the young lions do lack and suffer hunger, but they, referring again to all believers who seek the Lord, shall not be in want of any good thing. No employer can keep God's will from me. Think about that. Nothing on this earth can keep God's will from me. Nothing on this earth can penetrate that thick egg white of God's love that's protecting me and loving me and accomplishing God's will in and through me throughout this life. Nothing. Because the Creator is so much greater than the created. When we believe this, I'm just a prisoner of the Lord. Our spouse doesn't need to change a thing for us to be content. Nothing needs to change to be content. Nothing. If that's how I see myself going throughout the day, I'm not the prisoner of this job. I'm not the prisoner of my health condition. I'm not the prisoner of anything. I'm the prisoner of the one who created me. What a glorious truth. When we believe that, as God etches that deeper and deeper into our lives, that enables us then to walk humbly with others, which is point two of your outline. Now Paul transitions from our security in God. We don't need a thing from anybody else. Because I don't need anything from you. Now I'm free to walk humbly with you. And what does that mean? Verse 1 and just the first three words of verse 2. Again, read. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you've been called, with all humility. Now, we'll come back to humility here in a minute. First, Paul says, I implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you've been called. Paul is simply saying here, I strongly urge you. Look how important he makes this. He just finished talking about God's love and being a prisoner of the Lord. And he turns and says, I strongly urge you to walk consistent with your new life in Christ. That's what he's saying, to walk worthy of your calling, walk consistent with who you are, a new creation in Christ. And how do we do that? Now, until we understand this again, if we just lift these words, take this verse, I implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling. Ooh, boy, that sounds like a heavy burden. Doesn't it? Especially when he says, I implore you to walk in your calling with humility, with gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for everybody else's faults. Oh, my word. We don't even get through the list, and I already feel like a miserable failure. Now we've learned that nowhere in Scripture does God burden us with exemplifying God's life. Come to me, he says, and you'll find rest for your souls. Well, that isn't consistent with leave here and feel terribly guilty and try harder to walk all four of these ways and come back and report next week how successful you were at it. So what does this mean? How do we understand this? Well, we've learned. We never lift one verse or one phrase out of Scripture and make a message on it. We understand it in light of all of Scripture. And what does all of Scripture say? Whenever we understand a phrase like this, the first thing we look at is the context. What does the context say? Well, Paul introduced chapter 4. This is just three verses before this. He introduced chapter 4 by saying it's God's power working within us that accomplishes our walking worthy of our calling with others. Note verse 20 of chapter 3. Just two verses up from this verse. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. Oh, I start to feel my shoulders drop. There it is. He introduced everything he's going to say with, I'm going to continue to express these commands because they are God's commanded way of living. They are righteous living. They are what God wills for our life. But he just said, and this is really the difference between, and I'll talk more about this in a later lesson, the old covenant and the new. Living under the law and living under grace as we do today. God put his spirit in us to accomplish this command in us as we read it. The author of this command, praise God, I implore you to walk in a manner worthy. The author of those words now lives in me. And we've seen repeatedly where he said in Scripture, I'm writing this on your heart as you read it. Praise God. Here's another verse. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 and 24 say, Now may the God of peace himself, emphasizing by himself, sanctify you entirely. That means accomplish your entire spiritual growth, what we think of as the Christian life, and everything else with it. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your soul, spirit and soul and body be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he who calls you, and he also will bring it to pass. So Paul says here, the one who calls us to walk in a manner worthy of our calling brings that to pass in us. And every time I see that in Scripture, I say, praise God, praise God, praise God. That's why I keep pointing it out to you. How again does he do that? How does he bring this to pass? He told us clearly. We're going to talk about briefly here and then go on to the other walks in our next two lessons. But how does he bring to pass this command of, I implore you to walk in a manner worthy with all humility? 1 Thessalonians 2:13 again says, For this reason we also constantly thank God that when you received the word of God which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the word of men, but for what it really is, the word of God. That's what we're studying. Which does what? The word of God does what? Which also performs its work in you who believe. Who believe just simply means you believers. The Word of God performs it in me. So, keep in mind as we study the first worthy walk of humility in Ephesians 4:2, we realize God is shaping our life according to what we're studying right as we're studying this. This is a glorious truth for us to know. The power is in God's Word through His Spirit in us. So again, the first three words of verse 2 are, with all humility. Now the word humility here means to esteem ourselves small. Or it means to squat down or to crouch down in our spirit in relationship to others. So in all of our relationships, Paul is saying here, we should look up in respect to others and a desire to please them, not ourselves. Remember, he set us totally free from needing to please myself or look out for myself because God's looking out for me. I'm his prisoner. I'm the egg yolk and the thick egg white. I I'm free now to just squat down in my relationship with Rodney, with Chris, with Steve, with Chrissy, with Kelly. I'm not any of your prisoners. I'm God's prisoner. I don't have to defend myself. It doesn't mean I don't discuss if you've made an error on my paycheck, but I don't have to get stressed over to argue it, because God's going to make good to me. His thick egg white encases me. Squatting down in my relationship with everyone, first my wife, is in contrast to our pride that wants to stand tall and expect others to please us and make us happy. When Cheryl and I first moved to Coeur d'Alene, we were teaching a Bible study over at Coeur d'Alene Bible Church. And because we were teaching the class, and I did a couple marriage seminars, we had a number of couples come in over 4 or 5 years and ask for some marriage counsel. And Cheryl and I were just amazed by the number of husbands who would say to us soon into that counsel in a gruff, kind of angry way, "My wife just needs to submit to me." I can't tell you how many times we heard that here in Coeur d'Alene. And I said, "Cheryl, we're hearing this from so many men." And they'd take me aside and want to have lunch with me alone. And when they got me cornered, "Daryl, everything would be fine if my wife would just submit to me. Can you get her to do that?" We never once heard, never once a husband asked the question, "Daryl, what does it mean to walk humbly with my wife?" That's right here. I'm not paraphrasing. It's right here in Scripture. Just time and again, my wife needs to submit to me. And everything would be fine then. Well, I'll just make this brief little comment. We're going to get to that infamous submission verse in chapter 5. Interestingly enough, we're going to see that verse is immediately preceded by a verse that says both husband and wife are to submit to each other. Totally. But I never heard that discussed. See, our pride wants to grab verses out of Scripture to try to get others to do what they should do in order to please us and make us happy. And we look for verses to beat people over the head until God brings us to see that we're His prisoner. Then we don't need to beat. We don't even feel we need to. There's no desire in us to beat anybody over the head. We don't need anything. God's thick egg white completely encases me. Romans 12:10 says, "Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in love." The Living Bible paraphrase reads, "Love each other with brotherly affection and take delight in honoring each other." The word honor in general includes showing recognition and appreciation. However, its usage here has a much deeper meaning. God asks us to honor each other because Christ dwells in each of our lives. So to walk humbly with Cheryl, my wife, is to respect that the Lord lives in her and is at work in her life. And to honor every other believer is to respect the same. I'm encased in God's thick egg white, loving and caring for me and working in my life, and so is every other believer. Philippians 2:13 again says, and I'll be done here in 3 minutes, "For it is God who is at work." I love the word "is," meaning currently and continually, "in you," referring to all believers, both to will and to work for His good pleasure. "When we walk humbly with each other, remembering this, that God is at work in my wife. The Creator God is at work in my spouse. The Creator God is at work in my friend who there's some troubling things I see in their life. I'm encased in His thick egg white, and God's love is working in their life." There isn't a question about it. Scripture says it, and God can't lie. Well, why do I see them doing some things? Because I can tell you from my own life, God allowed me to worship making money until I got to the point where enough was never enough. And just at that moment, the Lord appeared to me in that hospital room and showed me that He was the peace I'd been seeking. And my life has been forever changed. He knows how He needs to deal with each one of us. He's the Creator God. I'm encased in His egg white, and so is my wife. "When we walk humbly with each other, remembering this," this eliminates all critical and judgmental feelings towards one another. It eliminates imposing a performance standard on others that makes them feel they're not good enough. Once I understand that God is at work in me and God is at work in you, and He's the "how great thou art God," and He's going to accomplish His will in you because He says all of His will be accomplished, why would I impose a performance standard on you? Who am I? In the beginning of Romans chapter 14, Paul encourages believers to not be critical of each other, but to honor one another, because he says in the Living Bible paraphrase, and I used this verse to conclude with because I just love how direct and clear it is. In this passage, if you go read it, one believer wanted to criticize another believer because he wasn't doing something right, and the other believer wanted to criticize the other one because he wasn't doing something right. You can read it in Romans chapter 14. And Paul says to one about the other, "They are God's servants, not yours. They are responsible to Him, not to you. Let Him tell them whether they are right or wrong." And I love these last words. "And God is able to make them do as they should." This doesn't mean we don't discuss concerns with one another from time to time. This doesn't mean I don't discuss something on my heart with Cheryl or with a friend. Next week, this is the first part of a 3-part study, as I've shared. Next week, we'll see Paul tell us clearly whether we should discuss that concern or just pray about it, and God's going to remind us that she belongs to God. Not He will accomplish His will in her life. I don't need to badger her or him. How glorious is that? But if He wants to use me as an instrument, He'll make me to know that. It won't come from my pride or my fear. And it won't come from me needing to tell them to change so that I can become happier, because God has brought me to understand the greatness of His love that surrounds me, and that's made me content. My only interest in sharing anything with Cheryl or with you is not for me to be happier, it's for your well-being. Wish we could go on. Our time is up. Thank you, Lord, for your glorious word and how it speaks so practically to us. I know all of us hearing this lesson tonight have hearts saying, Lord, make your love for me so thick and so evident to me that I too say I'm just a prisoner of the Lord. And those just aren't words. That's my peace statement. And in turn, Lord, we know as we study these words that you are shaping our clay and forming this humble walk in us towards others. We just praise you for it. In Christ's name, amen.